All right? So, and maybe we can take this opportunity to start, right? Is that okay? Erica, you give me permission?
Yes.
It's nice to start on time just because there's so much to talk about tonight, and there are so many really great guests, both here on the dais and in the auditorium. So I would like to welcome you all to MoMA's R&D Salon number 27. It is a very special and difficult and important day for New Yorkers, so I'm really happy that I'm spending it here with you, and I'm happy that we're all together. I have little shivers down my spine, as I'm sure you have, but it's the best way to spend it, and especially to talk about something as important and as delicate and as powerful as gastrodiplomacy. The image that you see here is from the Carnival of Ivrea. Ivrea is a small city in Piedmont in Italy that might be known to some of you because if you're architecture buffs, because it's the place where the Olivetti headquarters are, really great architecture, but otherwise it's a small city with, as an Italian city, old traditions. And one of these traditions is the orange fight every carnival in February. It goes back to the medieval ages, and there's like histories behind of like a tyrant sir of the city and a young virgin girl that he kind of mistreated and abused and raped, and the citizens went into this upheaval, and there was a gigantic fight that is celebrated every February. Some people say that the oranges that are thrown signify the rocks and that once upon a time they were beans. Others say that they signify the testicles of the sir of the house. You know, no matter what, it's an old tradition that is celebrated, and it's really war of food. But of course, gastrodiplomacy is much more of that. Food occupies a very important role in our life as human beings. And you know, Leonardo da Vinci very unceremoniously said that man is a transit, a conduit of food. So let's not even think about it too much. Typical Florentine. And instead, Feuerbach, a few years later, instead declared man is what he eats. So you see, there's a notion of history and of different perception of the role of food in those centuries. And that particular statement, the fact that man or woman or any kind of being is what he or she eats, is really where culture begins. And we wanted to celebrate it with this beautiful image by Bruno Munari. Bruno Munari is an artist and designer from Italy that besides making this beautiful speaking forks, also did a beautiful dictionary of the Italian language by gestures. So it really is about food expressing, signifying people's identity. You know, there's a quantitative way to think of food and the role that food has in the world. This is a great survey that was done by National Geographic a few years ago that's called What the World Eats. And you see here that you can already kind of identify disparities and different characters of populations in the world by looking at the type of calories that they consume, whether it's grain, produce, dairy and eggs, meat, sugar and fat, or other. And of course, the first thing that we asked ourselves when we prepared this PowerPoint was, what's other? Well, it's alcoholic drinks, and then it's, what's it called? Pulses. We didn't know what pulses was. Pulses is legumes, right? Legumes, and then other miscellanea. And you can tell here that the division can also speak so much more about what a country really stands for. And even more so when you try and compare the consumption of grains as opposed to the consumption of meat. And you see here that meat is a signifier, of course, of different traditions, but also of different richness. And in a way, knowing what the meat industry signifies when it comes to the environment, it also points fingers at a different kind of responsibility. So this is a quantitative look at the consumption of food in the world. Well, this you could say is a qualitative one. I really loved this New York Times Magazine special that was about children and what they have for breakfast around the world. And of course, I really loved Tiago in Sao Paulo. I mean, how could you not adore him? And it's really quite wonderful to just, without knowing much scientifically or sociologically, just to look at the food that is in front of a person and trying to guess or immediately put yourself in their shoes or in their mouths. You know, there's really this kind of subliminal and direct way to understand other humans via food. Of course, food can also be used, because it's such a universal language, it could also be used in other ways. And the Big Mac Index is something that was invented in 1986 when McDonald's was truly standardized and kind of all over the world. And it's the economist that tried to use the Big Mac as a measure of the parity of what was it called? Profit per purchase. It was about purchase power parity. Thank you so much. So it was a way to use the Big Macs as a balancing act and as a variable that would enable people to understand the different purchasing power in different parts of the world. Of course, today, things have changed so much, and the gastrodiplomacy itself has made it so that the Big Mac cannot be standardized and cannot be an index anymore, because even McDonald's has adapted to the fact that there's culture to food, and it's a culture that has a lot to do with national and global and local ideas. Food is therefore an instrument of soft power, but it can also be an instrument of hard power. And as Kissinger famously said in 1970, that if you control food, you control the people, it really proved to be so in history. If you Google, or if you try to find out about the list of famines that happened in history, it's staggering. We selected just a few here today, and we overlaid it onto the cover of Alex de Waal's book, Mass Starvation, in which Alex de Waal makes the argument that famines are never just coming from natural causes. They're always man-made, and they are akin to genocide. So they're really crimes against the people. And you see here just a few, the famine provoked by the Soviet Union in Ukraine in the 1930s that killed millions and millions of people, the Great Bengal Famine of 1943, all the way to the most recent Yemeni famine that's provoked by the blockade that the Saudis are operating at the border. So it's still a method of control, and it's as hard as it gets. Talk about soft power. But that's, on the other hand, kind of a rule. Whenever we talk about soft power, it can also be hard, depending in whose hands it is. And when it is in the hands, for instance, of protesters, hunger has become a method of protest that is really universal. We're looking here at the troubles in Ireland, and of course the famous history of Bobby Sands, the Irish hunger striker, not to mention Gandhi, and more recently Iram Chanu Sharmila from the Manipur region of India that has had held the record for the longest hunger strike. And she ended it in 2016, but she had been on hunger strike for more than 10 years. So hunger as a way to really make your voice heard and to protest, because it is so visceral, and I'm not making a pun here, it really represents a sacrifice that people can understand, that they can really make their own. So today we're here to discuss culinary diplomacy, gastrodiplomacy, social gastronomy. We're here to discuss gastrodiplomacy, but I think it's important to make a little distinction about these three terms. Culinary diplomacy is a form of cultural diplomacy exercised by governments that uses cuisine as a means to further diplomatic protocol. It is one of the oldest forms of diplomacy and a modern example of soft power, goes without saying. And one of the best examples and the funniest is Richard Nixon and his trip to China in 1972. History says that both Nixon and Kissinger got chopstick lessons on the plane. It was not very successful. And you see here some of the funniest, so he's there with Chu and Lai, and he's really not doing too good. I particularly like this one, like, what am I eating? So it really is cultural diplomacy at its finest. And one of the most recent examples this year was the summit between North and South Korea. The menu is fantastic. You should find it online. It starts out with arrosti, and you wonder why, because it's a Swiss. Well, because apparently Kim Jong-un went to school in Switzerland, so it's a way to remember him of those carefree times when he was in school, just to put him in the right mood. And then there was that fish that was coming from Busan, that's the southern South Korea town that the premier of South Korea was from, to end with that with that dessert that provoked another diplomatic incident, this time with Japan, because it was like this ball of chocolate that had to be broken with a little hammer, and inside was this mango pudding with on top the profile of these contested islands that Japan claims as its own, and instead the two Koreas saying it's Korean. So the enemy of my enemy is my friend, and so on and so forth. And actually, Japan protested officially against the dessert. So it really, but also all the other elements of the menu are fantastic. So I really recommend you look at them. Not to talk about, not to mention the hummus wars. So at some point, Israel tried to make it so to declare hummus their own national dish. Lebanon could not really accept that. And so there was this declaration of war that was a different kind of war between Israel and Lebanon that actually was fought together with the Guinness Book. So at first, Israel made a 4,000 kilo plate of hummus, and Lebanon won with 10,000. So it was just like about who makes the biggest hummus. And this is a great illustration from by the Art of Bou, who's an illustrator in Lebanon, that was given to us by Ala Tanir, that is actually a beautiful ode. If anybody here is Lebanese, they recognize themselves in this beautiful kind of analysis of hummus. So gastrodiplomacy instead is a public diplomacy attempt to communicate culinary culture to foreign publics. So it really is about making people understand a national brand. It seeks to influence the broader public audience rather than high-level elites. So it's about the people. It's about popular cuisine. Gastrodiplomacy is an approach also used by governments to raise international awareness of a country's edible nation brand through the promotion of its culinary and cultural heritage. The first nation to apply gastrodiplomacy from this viewpoint was Thailand. It was a concerted effort that was really concocted at national government, by national government, and other countries followed suit, you know, from, I'll go through it, many, even Peru. So gastrodiplomacy is a very important way to distribute and disseminate national brand. You see here on the left-hand side the document that established the Diplomatic Culinary Partnership Initiative, for which a series of chefs that you see over there, it was actually Hillary Clinton that put it together, a series of chefs were dispatched, and some of the best chefs in the United States were dispatched all over the world as ambassadors. And you see there in the middle, Christeta Comerford, who's the executive chef of the White House, and then next to her is our own William Yosses, who's here tonight. And so this group of chefs, which is, we'll have to ask you, Bill, what the deal is. It's very homogeneous and kind of weirdly, not too many women or people of color, but we'll discuss it later. Thank God there's Obama in the middle. And gastrodiplomacy, and then it's also a way to look at how different cultures have dealt with culinary tradition. And one of the most important aspects is colonialism and slavery and the transference of values and of cultures from one side to the other. Now, when it comes to the role of African American and especially African cuisine in the United States, we need to remember there Edna Lewis, who's the grand dame that actually gave American cuisine a status and recognized its roots in slavery and in the culture coming from Africa. And there are amazing books that you might find also in the reading list that discuss this particular aspect. And of course, then there's the colonialism all over the world. And we're talking here only about UK and France, but you can find that pretty much in all colonial powers. When it comes to the UK, at some point there was this idea of having empire shops in England. They never happened, but there were a way to open stores all over the UK that would actually show the foods coming from all the parts of the empire. And recently, there's a great group of artists and architects and writers that did this Empire Remain shop, and they hypothesized the idea of returning all the ingredients that were coming from other parts of the world in the British Empire back to the country. So if you did so, the classical British pudding would not be that British after all. So it's fascinating to see how the contaminations happen and the appropriations happen. Another great example, and we move now to France, is the banh mi. So the banh mi is a sandwich made with a baguette when Vietnam was part of Indochine. So the baguette was imported from France. And it was done using a lot of local Vietnamese ingredients with then some French ingredients added. So you would have the baguette, cilantro, all sorts of Vietnamese ingredients, and then some pâté on top. And then during the Vietnam War, Americans decided to import the banh mi to the United States. So there are all these in very interesting translations of foods that happen all over the world that are not yet that well recognized. So there are many people that are laboring towards that particular goal. Now, to go back home, Italy, of course, is using cuisine as a method of soft power till kingdom comes, but it also made it so that because we use it so much, it was also used as a way to criticize Italy. So you see there the classic stereotype, when Erica Petrillo, who's the wonderful R&D research assistant that helped us throughout the year and that also put together this presentation, is also from Milan, and so we were laughing at the stereotype of pizza and mandolino that Italians always put forward. But in 1977, that scandalous cover of Der Spiegel came out. You know, Italy was in the middle of a really difficult moment, terrorism, kidnappings, etc. And the spaghetti dish with the gun on top, and the idea that going to Italy on vacation meant, you know, making it out alive if you're lucky, was particularly offensive to Italians. So it was a big diplomatic accident. Of course, we can move then to the Expo in 2015 that is a celebration instead of, it was an orgy of gastrodiplomacy. You know, I don't know how many of you have been, it was just amazing, but it really used as leverage this particular strength that Italy has with food. Last but not least, social gastronomy, which uses the power of food and gastronomy to address social inequality, improve nutrition education, eliminate food waste, and create local jobs. And it's wonderful because the speakers that we have here today will address every single one of these three categories and will bring some amazing experience to it. When we talk about that, you know, a great example that you might have heard about is Conflict Kitchen out of Pittsburgh. That is an association that in the 7 years, I think, 7 or 8 years that it existed, has periodically brought to the public the food of countries with which America, the United States, are in conflict. So it ranges from Palestine to Cuba and so on and so forth, and Venezuela. So really quite fascinating as an instrument of understanding and of empathy of other cultures. And here are our speakers for tonight. They are wonderful, and I am so proud to have them here. First will be Johanna Mendelssohn-Forman. Johanna is a professor at the American University School of International Service, and her course is called Conflict Cuisine, an introduction to war and peace around the dinner table. And she's also one of the foremost experts on gastrodiplomacy, so it's really a treat to have her. After her, we will have Bill Yossis. Bill Yossis is an extraordinary chef, and he used to be the pastry chef at the White House for 7 years until 2014. So he has firsthand stories about gastrodiplomacy that are incredibly precious. After him, we'll have Peter Kim. Peter Kim is a food activist. He's always been interested in the issue of hunger, and he's the founder of the Museum of Food and Drink here in New York City. It's a labor of love. It truly is about his passion, and this museum that is now, it's still in Williamsburg, right, Peter? Yeah, it's in Williamsburg, and I know that you were about to find another location, but the way it addresses food is always about, you know, thinking about science or thinking about sociology and politics, so in a way that really connects food with real life and with the world. After him, we will have John Gray. John is the wonderful co-founder of Ghetto Gastro, which is an initiative of a community, a group of activists based in the Bronx that use cuisine exactly as a method for addressing social issues. And it's the intersection of food design and community empowerment. And he's a wonderful activist, also because the way he goes about it is so irresistible. And last but not least, we'll have Linyi Yuan, who's the founder and editor of Mold, a great online magazine and offline magazine. It's also a paper magazine that deals with food, looking at the different intersection of it. And you can tell from the name Mold that it's a publication that talks about the way food is prepared also, and the way the publication is prepared is as telling as that. Throughout the presentation, throughout the night, we will have also the great innovation that Erica operated this year that she was here, 1 minute videos from different experts that we called upon from all over the world. And at the end, we will have a chance to talk together, and then we will have a chance to eat together and to drink together. And as I mentioned to you before, the food will be provided by Emma Storch. Emma Storch is a wonderful foundation that works with refugees, that through the power of food and gastronomy helps refugees find new education and a new job through food. Lastly, we would like to celebrate here one of the greatest gastro diplomats of all. And we're not talking about Obama, we're talking about Anthony Bourdain. These are the famous pictures of them eating together in Hanoi, and we were laughing because the plastic stools and the table has been now framed and encased in plexi. But so we would like to, dedicate this evening to Bourdain. So without further ado, I'm going to start with the first video, and then I'm going to call Johanna Mendelssohn to the podium. Oh, yeah. There. Johanna Mendelssohn-Forman. Well, there are so many people to thank tonight, but Paola, thank you for including my favorite video and not counting it as a red card against my time, because it is 2.5 minutes, but it really is wonderful to see it on a big screen. I hope you all enjoyed it, and thank you, Government of Canada, for doing that. So tonight, when Erica and Paola called me, I wanted to thank you for allowing me to talk about some passion that I have, the intersection of food and foreign policy. You know, after decades of trying to solve some of the world's most intractable conflicts, I concluded that bringing people together around a common table and focusing on the cultural dimensions of a cuisine as a language that all parties could understand may be a better way to build peace than any other form of development intervention. And I really do believe that the kitchen is a new venue of foreign policy. So people ask me, well, what is conflict cuisine? And that is how I started to use food as a way to teach students about conflict and peace building. In the city of Washington, D.C., I discovered an urban laboratory. And it was no secret that you could always look at new restaurants that refugees were opening and know where they were from wars that were happening around the world. And one day I decided these conflict cuisines, the food prepared by people escaping war and violence, could be a better way to show students about the power of food to preserve memories of home and also to provide livelihoods to survival. And this is how I came up with a course that is now in its fifth year and is always oversubscribed on the day it is posted. But I do more than that. When I started the conflict cuisine project, I didn't know that I was also becoming part of a growing movement of people, of chefs, of private citizens and governments who were all looking to food as a way to promote social change. So food is a form of soft power, and I think Paola did a wonderful job of going through all the definitions, and I'm going to try and make this short. But I found myself in the midst of a global food revolution, and it is a revolution that takes place on many fronts with many players. There are chefs, there are millennials, there are scientists, there are environmentalists, there are also diplomats, corporations, and governments, activists of all stripes to create a better world by connecting the way food consumption, food waste, production, and equal access can also help address some of the most existential problems that we face. And don't forget, I'm a policy wonk, climate change, wars, refugees, and the rise of megacities. And food is going to be a problem by 2050 when 80% of the world's population live in urban areas. So we live in what one sociologist has described as the age of ethical eating. It is at the heart of a revolution to create a more sustainable planet, to ensure that no one goes hungry, and that we give value to those who produce our food, but also embrace those who consume it. Some theologians have recently suggested that coming around a table may be a place where we find spiritual connection in an age when formal religious institutions are losing millennials. The use of food as a tool for political change is not only powerful, but it is empowering. So food is soft power, and there are these four forms that Paola went over, but I want to suggest, and Bill Yassis will probably talk about culinary diplomacy as well from his years in the White House and with the Chef's Corps. Think about state dinners. That's what culinary diplomacy is. But I have an interesting story for you. In 2015, during the negotiations for the nuclear deal with Iran, a curious thing happened. On July 4th, our national day, Iranian Foreign Minister Javad Zarif offered to host a lunch for Secretary Kerry and his delegation. This lunch featured lovely Persian food served in the palatial grandeur of the hotel in Lausanne, Switzerland. And it was the first time that the U.S. and the Iranian delegations had met face-to-face in a non-negotiating room setting. Journalist Robin Wright, who described this from interviews with the U.S. staff, noted the event really humanized both sides for the first time. They shared food and drink, and it had an important impact. We may never know if that lunch was the turning point, but we do know that the agreement was reached 6 days later, something that was not assured before both sides sat down and broke bread together. This is culinary diplomacy. Now, we've mentioned gastrodiplomacy as well. I'm going to just move my slide, and that was my... Okay, I had to show you that slide because of the contrasts.
Sorry, I know food is political. We said food is political, Paola. So we're all gastrodiplomats. We're citizens who engage in consuming the foods of other cultures as a way of learning new things. And it is true, most people learn about other cultures through their palates. Think about food trucks. Think about food courts that serve up exotic cuisines. I understand Queens has now become the gastrodiplomacy destination, judging from the food tours I see advertised. It wasn't that way when I grew up there, but I'm glad to hear that it is. And then there's nation branding. And Paola referred to this, but food has played a very important role in the way middle powers seek a new identity. It is an act where using a unique regional cuisine specialty becomes a powerful tool to make a government popular again, to increase tourism, to rebuild national reputations, to make a demand for new cuisines as a national brand. And we mentioned Korea, Peru, Thailand have long established programs, and most recently, Malaysia and India have started these. But Thailand's success is very notable, and I know we're going to have a little clip from Mary Jo Pham, but just think about this. In 2001, the government of Thailand set up the Global Thai Restaurant Corporation, and its effort was to establish 3,000 new Thai restaurants worldwide. And here was the result. Not only did they offer small grants to expats, but they increased the number outside of Thailand from 5,500 to 15,000 in the course of a decade. Now, that's a pretty good nation branding program. And Peru did a similar thing, but for different reasons. Peru was suffering from a terrible civil war in the early 90s. Everybody who can think back on Sendero Luminoso knows they didn't go to Peru because of the violence. Today, people go to Peru not only to visit Machu Picchu, they go to Peru because they want to consume the incredible new indigenous cuisines that chefs are making, and also the Nikkei cooking, the fusion of Japanese cooking with the Andean cooking, making it a new important culinary destination. And I have to mention Mexico, because nobody talks about poor Mexico except in a negative way. But they also set up a very powerful nation branding program called Ven a Comer, Come to Eat, and it has made food, Mexican food, not a cliche of tamales or tacos. Today we see the transformation to high-end cooking. So you don't hear jokes about people going to Mexico and getting turista. You hear jokes about how can I nab a reservation at that hot new restaurant in Mexico City, Pujol. Now, social gastronomy. We've heard the definitions. It's doing good. There's actually a whole debate going on.
Oh, my two minutes.
Oh, I didn't know. I thought that you were looking at slides. Okay. Well, I just want to say social gastronomy, this is the picture of the chef's manifesto. This is what is going on right now. Chefs coming together, they've had a declaration in support of the Sustainable Development Goals. Maybe that won't come up. These are examples of social gastronomy in our area. This is the Brownsville Community Culinary Center. And this is David Hertz, who started one of the first projects and used the term in Brazil, gastromotiva. But that is something that we can talk about later in the discussion. I do have to get to food and conflict, though. That's sustainable development goal number two. In New York, you probably have seen this. Many people around the world have not seen this chart. But war and conflict, because this is what I do for a living, or did for a living for a long time. We know that in times of war, when there are mass movements of humanity and people fleeing oppression, food can be one of the most tangible remnants of displacement. Willful destructions of cities, communities cannot rob people of their cuisine. And unlike destroying a monument or a building, it is hard to destroy food memories. And a somber warning, we live in a century where the cheapest weapon of war in this century at the arsenal is food. It does not take an expert to understand that bad governments make food bad food policies. And withholding food from a country's citizen has made man-made famines to add to the suffering and the devastation that we all see around us. Think about it. We've seen the slide. Syria, Yemen, South Sudan, Eastern Congo, all of these are level three conflicts. And just remember this. Of the 815 million chronically food insecure people in the world, the vast majority, that's 489 million, live in countries afflicted by conflict. This proportion is even more pronounced for undernourished children. So make no mistake, one of the drivers of increasing of increasing urbanization is conflict, and this is especially in sub-Saharan Africa. Population growth and war will not cease. So we need a strategy for conflict prevention, and we need to continue to stop, we need to stop the weaponization of food. So I want to just conclude with this. The Golden Arches theory of democracy, very popular after the end of the Cold War. But can a hamburger build world peace? Well, we see two people eating hamburgers there, Medvedev and Donald Trump. But I want you to see this and judge for yourself.
So, Burger King's proposing a Burger War ceasefire to join forces with McDonald's on Peace Day and create the McWhopper. That's a big burger with big ambitions. A fair amount to swallow, right? So here's a little how, where, and why to help you digest our proposal. As two of the world's largest brands, we're in the perfect position to influence change. And like BK, McDonald's is committed to leveraging its size, scope, and resources to help make the world a better place. Peace One Day campaigns tirelessly for a better world. But they need our help raising awareness of Peace Day. We could rattle a bucket, but buckets aren't loud. Proposals like McWhopper make noise. Just ask this guy.
Hi, I'm Jeremy Gilley, founder of Peace One Day. The thing I love about the McWhopper project is it walks the walk. It leads by example and demonstrates a genuine commitment to Peace Day and a more peaceful and sustainable world. Corporate activation on this scale creates mass awareness, and awareness creates action, and action saves lives. We hope you get on board, McDonald's.
So do we, Jeremy. We can't do this without them. So we've made participation easy, one location, one day only. We've designed a proposed pop-up restaurant, the packaging, even the staff uniforms. All we have to do is park our differences for one day and do what we both do best. No strings. Together, let's blaze a trail, build the unthinkable burger, and feed the discussion. Let's end the beef with beef on Peace Day, September 21st, 2015.
So you tell me, will a hamburger build world peace? We can see. But one of the things that I want to close with is this statement. Jan Eliasson, who was the president of the General Assembly and the Undersecretary General of the UN, once said that the first thing we need to do is make peace with nature. And I think some of the speakers that follow are going to talk about the environmental impact of food. But thank you for your time, and happy to take your questions.
Thanks a lot. Afterwards. Thank you, Johanna. So let's cue in the next videos, please.
Gastrodiplomacy is how countries communicate their culture internationally through their cuisine. It is a practice that originated by a number of what's called middle power states. Middle powers are neither superpowers nor are they small actors in the global power dynamic. It's countries that exist somewhere in the middle, and they have to engage in public diplomacy and cultural diplomacy, and more recently in gastrodiplomacy, to differentiate their nation brand from other countries. So we've seen gastrodiplomacy campaigns by a number of middle power countries, such as Thailand, who is the originator, Taiwan, South Korea, Malaysia, Peru, among many others. But the field of gastrodiplomacy has also shifted in the last few years, where we've seen some of the superpowers or the culinary great powers, such as the US and France, conducting gastrodiplomacy campaigns. And the difference really is, while middle powers are trying to promote their culture in general to make global foreign publics more aware of who they are and what their culture entails, countries like the US through the Diplomatic Culinary Partnership, or France through its Goût France program, really focus on regional differences, on nuanced understanding of their culture and their edible nation brand, because global publics might think they know what U.S. Food entails, but the purpose of gastrodiplomacy is to try and show regional differences and different culinary nuances that exist in the culture.
Gastrodiplomacy could be a very effective political instrument when it comes to governments seeking to engage with everyday diners, sitting down at a table and cultivating a conversation around food, culture, history. Food has everything to do with, at its roots, with national identity, where food comes from, how it's grown, how it's made, who grows it, and who cooks it, who prepares it. And these are very important elements to a country's national narrative and to their national brand. And while all of this is incredibly important, food alone is not going to be the answer to any single country's foreign policy engagement strategy. Food and gastrodiplomacy needs to be conducted in concert with a country's broader strategies. And when it is leveraged correctly, it can really build strong ties between people.
Bill, please come. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm so excited to be here. What a fantastic subject. And it's one that I only heard of a few years ago, the subject of culinary diplomacy. I was already working at the White House, but it was actually one of Joanna's future students that was studying this subject at Tufts University. And it sounded so compelling and interesting to me, and I sort of stuck with the subject. And it has grown into a very, very important part of our government, although in its current form, it's not really being exercised as well as it could be. But I suppose food in general, we have to think of it as the first civilizing influence when we think of the first hominids or first cave people. When they sat down around the fire, that's probably one of the first times they stopped fighting each other and began to eat and enjoy their time together. So these days, it's always good to start out a talk with a picture of Barack Obama, I feel. Don't we? We all have a certain sort of hungry desire to see him again in public discourse. I chose this particular slide because it will illustrate one of his great attributes, which is his sense of humor, and very dry, very, as you know, very sort of English and droll. But if you'll look at the shoes I'm wearing, I was brave enough to wear that for the photograph, and he whispered to me in a sort of so loud stage whisper, "When I finish this job, I'm going to start wearing shoes like that." So I'm still waiting, Mr. President. He still has a pretty conservative dress code. But it was my honor and privilege to work for the White House and for particularly that administration. And my real boss was Michelle Obama, because she's the one that organized events and activities at the White House. So whether it was a small breakfast or whether it was a state dinner, those that came through her office. I presume this is how I advanced.
Green arrow.
Thank you. And the Obamas, Mrs. Obama as well as President Obama, understood the power of food, and her first initiative, and the longest one that I experienced while I was there, was her program, which came to be known as Let's Move. It used food as both a symbolic and a very practical policy initiative. The idea was to really make people aware of the importance of food in every society, but also in the most disadvantaged parts of America. So the first step in that was to plant this garden on the South Lawn, which was no easy feat. Everything in Washington is covered in red tape, and even for a first lady. It took a bit of doing, but as I often say about Mrs. Obama, it's you've heard of iron hand in a velvet glove. Well, in her case, it's the Sherman tank in a velvet glove. But that power is very persuasive, and cordiality and love and kindness are her methods. She started this garden and asked us as chefs at the White House to help her spread this message of awareness of eating and healthier eating. And so this beautiful garden was what we as chefs there came to be to know as our larder, and where we went when we were looking for new ideas for recipes or for any kind of meal that we were serving. One of my favorite views of this incredible building, surveyed first by George Washington and built by James Hoban, an Irishman. I still think it's one of the most beautiful buildings in America. There was also a beehive as part of our program there, in which the plan was and still is to show people the importance of food in relationship to the environment, and probably no other way to do that, no better way to do that than to show the vulnerability of the social insects, and especially bees, whose very existence is threatened by the ecological damage that's being done to our planet. So this was all a very well thought out program that Mrs. Obama had created. Need a little water to continue, excuse me. But we as chefs were enlisted in this army of people who were there talking to students, to anybody that would listen, about the way food affects our lives, our diplomatic corps, and our environment in general. And certainly there's probably nothing that infects our daily life more than the way we grow, distribute, and cook our food. I have 15 more slides, so get ready. 2 minutes. So food as a symbol. This is the White House made out of white chocolate, which was one of my jobs when I was at the White House. We created a gingerbread house, but in this case, it's a white chocolate gingerbread house. And food as symbol is what we're sort of talking about here when we talk about gastrodiplomacy, because it's... yes, we do have these state dinners where we bring diplomats together, and they are they come together around a table, and hopefully their treaties and their military needs and comparisons are sort of softened by the meal that they have. But it's still a symbol. Now we're going to jump to this was Hillary Clinton's program. When she was the Secretary of State, in which she invited us, you heard about earlier, as chefs, to become culinary ambassadors around the world. So when I first heard about it, and some of the chefs went out, they were sent to France and Italy and Japan, and then when my ticket came up, it said Uzbekistan, so which I didn't really know where it was at the time, but I was fascinated to learn that it is really the center of the Silk Road and sort of one of the first crossroads of culinary diplomacy, where Marco Polo traveled and these culinary traditions went back and forth between the East and the West. So I'll click through these quickly, but it was a fascinating trip. This is plov, which is the national dish of Uzbekistan. It's a lamb and rice dish. Over there on the left, you can see this great banquet hall where people from all over Tashkent, the capital, came together and enjoyed this incredible meal. Farther on the left was my so-called tour guide, the one on the left there. He was actually a KGB agent. There was really no tourism in Uzbekistan at the time, but he followed us very closely, and he never even left the hotel lobby as we went through the country. This was my culinary class at the Tashkent Culinary School. So we have this young man here holding a pumpkin pie, my effort at introducing American cuisine. some of the beautiful Silk Road sort of traditions of Uzbekistan. Another one of the national dishes, lakman, where you see noodles, which sort of were made popular by this this sort of Marco Polo tradition of China and Europe. Bringing apple pie to Uzbekistan And then this lady is a pastry chef in Uzbekistan. She showed us how to make their version. There I am with, okay, the salad. This is the culinary and fashion school in Kiva. And there's me on a dromedary.
Oh, thank you. Sorry.
Thank you, darling. It's quite all right. It's quite all right.
I am so sorry. Next video is up, please. Thank you, Bill.
Can we like the food of our rivals? And can we come to like our rivals through liking their food? My answers are yes and no, respectively. Food is fundamental to the affective experience of identity and difference. Through food, we not only symbolize our identities, but often experience them in a very embodied way. Yet food is not just a social and cultural medium, it is also a nutritional, political, and economic resource. And all these aspects of food participate in shaping consumption patterns and meanings. While food is always political, people's attitude towards specific foods or even whole cuisines are never simply a reflection of political relations. Political units might split, rivalries formed in the process, while the plane of taste does not change in parallel ways. People may carve out national cuisines out of what was once a single culinary landscape, and small distinctions, which were previously insignificant, begin to function as signs of difference. Yet political struggles are never about cuisine, although they may be expressed through cuisine, and therefore culinary acts of political goodwill run the risk of being perceived as empty gestures by the less powerful.
Peter? Yes. Thank you, Daphna. And here's Peter Kim.
Hi, good evening. So about 15 years ago, I was a Peace Corps volunteer in Cameroon in Central Africa in a village named Bankim. I was doing public health work. And one of my crowning achievements of all of my time in the Peace Corps was actually simply fitting in. It was such a different culture. And one of the ways in which that I fit in with my community was by participating in that village's food and drink traditions. Learning how to peel the outside of the orange just so you could cut the top off and squeeze fresh orange juice right in your mouth from the women in the market. Going to fields and tending crops and going fishing. Learning how to pound cassava roots into fufu. With my Muslim friends fasting during Ramadan, with my non-Muslim friends drinking palm wine under one of the magnificent trees in my village. Now, this is all about me learning about the food culture of my village, but I wanted to show something from my culture. And so one November, I decided I wanted to make Thanksgiving dinner. Now, making Thanksgiving dinner in rural Cameroon is not for the faint of heart. Celery, sweet potatoes, green beans, ingredients like this. I had to talk to a guy who had to find a guy who'd help me up with a guy who was growing this. Getting a turkey, you know, forget about it. Even describing what a turkey was, it's like a giant chicken. I gave up on that one and settled for a couple of scrappy village chickens. At the end of the day, the meal, I would say, on its face, didn't really resemble a Thanksgiving meal per se. But looked at differently, it was the perfect embodiment of a Thanksgiving meal. I stood around the table with my village friends and we gave thanks, and I felt I had shared something deeply personal with them. And in that moment, I felt something very powerful. I felt I was home. And to me, this really, this memory hammers home the deep power of food. It can create bridges across cultures. But what about when it doesn't? And can food actually be anti-diplomatic? That's to say, can it create and perpetuate negative images or opinions about a culture? So for that, let's flash back to the mid-1800s. Chinese immigrants are coming to the US to work in gold mines and to work on the railroad. And there are simmering tensions between these new arrivals and some of the predominantly white workers in the US who view them as competition and also a threat to public safety. In the 1870s and 80s, there was a just absolutely terrible anti-Chinese wave of violence and racism. You saw beatings, harassment, massacres, even lynchings. And the feeling of anti-Chinese sentiment was so strong at this point that in 1882, the federal government, with bipartisan legislation, enacted the Chinese Exclusion Act, which in essence told the Chinese, you don't belong in this country. It banned all immigration from China, and it's a law that was in place for over 80 years. Right around the same time as the Exclusion Act, there were groups of wealthy urbanites. Oh, sorry, this is some of the rhetoric from the Exclusion Act. But right around the same time as the Exclusion Act, there were these groups of young urbanites in New York City that took a liking to going into immigrant neighborhoods like Chinatown and trying foods. It was sort of an exercise in voyeurism to see how the other sort of side lived. It was called slumming. And when they would go into restaurants, I could only imagine that what they were doing was basically pointing at the menu and just sort of picking things willy-nilly. For reasons unknown, one dish sort of rose up as being a popular dish to choose. It was a dish called chow chop suey. This is a traditional Cantonese dish that is a stir fry of originally, typically organ meat with ingredients such as wood ear mushrooms and bean sprouts. And it became a sort of marker of cultural coolness to know where to go in Chinatown to order this dish. Then from there, as food trends go, it became a sort of citywide phenomenon, and the New York Times by 1900 had declared the city chop suey mad. From there, it emanated out to the country and it became a nationwide phenomenon. While this was happening, Chinese restaurateurs were responding by actually opening more restaurants and fine-tuning the recipe to have the ingredients be more friendly for mainstream non-Chinese tastes. Now, this was a period in America's history where people were just going bonkers for chop suey. There was, it was an affordable luxury. You could go out and eat chop suey. Magazines were telling you how to throw chop suey parties at home. Songs were written about chop suey. You could buy canned chop suey. You could buy frozen chop suey dinners. The thing that's crazy about this is that the same time as there is this obsession with Chinese American restaurants, the Exclusion Act is still in place. We are not allowing the Chinese into the country. What this means is essentially what's happening here is that people loved the food but hated the people making that food. And, you know, that's actually how chop suey got started, with slumming, as sort of looking at it at arm's length and, you know, thinking of this as sort of an exotic thing to try. And that sort of fed onto itself. And what you see in this case is food actually acting as a barrier. I remember having a conversation with the manager of Wohop in Chinatown. Some of you might know this restaurant. I've got much love for that place. And he told me his great uncle would tell him stories about how they would serve chop suey in the 30s and 40s to joyous customers. And then he would step outside on the street and things would change. People would tell him to go back to China or would hurl racial epithets at him. So, you know, this sort of dissonance between the food and the people, it actually continues to this day. MSG. There's this continuing fear of MSG, and it's sometimes referred to as Chinese restaurant syndrome. And this persists despite the fact that there is no scientific evidence of any sort of MSG allergy. You have the continuing stereotype of the so-called sort of dirty Chinese restaurant. And as a matter of fact, last year, there was a game called Dirty Chinese Restaurant that was actually created, and thankfully, they pulled the plug on that brilliant idea. And we're all familiar with the concept of greasy Chinese food, but what about greasy French food? I mean, my wife's French, and I love French food, but, you know, there's a lot of butter in that, and why aren't we calling that greasy Chinese food, or French food? Oh, God, see? I said it. It's horrible. You can credit Chinese food that you had yesterday for the gastrointestinal problems you're having today, but it's definitely never the fault of the Italian food, of course. You don't hear that. So what's my point here? My point is that gastrodiplomacy is indeed a powerful concept, That extraordinarily memorable meal I had in Cameroon is proof positive of that to me. But eating the food of another culture on its own does not mean understanding that culture. And, you know, I think worse, it can actually fuel misconceptions and it can even create disdain. So perhaps it's best to not place our focus so much on the food. And maybe we need to go beyond the plates and look at and truly understand the people and the processes behind the food that we eat. This requires intention, and it requires people, like my esteemed co-panelists and my colleagues at the museum, to encourage the people around them to really think a bit harder, to care a bit more. So I guess what I'm saying here is, let's think of food as the entry point and focus our thought on the really difficult work that comes with, well, what do we do with that and how we take it a few steps further? Then we can break bread and truly begin to understand each other better. Thank you.
Studying culinary history because I was in search of context. I was a chef confronting the world and needed to find a way to make sense of broad and abstract points in history. So all of a sudden, through the lens of food, World War II, the Civil War, the enslaved experience, the excesses of the 80s, the Black Lives Matter movement, all become interesting and clear and nuanced through the filter of food. And so I think society would do well to think more broadly about food as an integral part of culture, not just as this sort of abstract anthropological endeavor, but this really honest, clear discipline that asks us to start with humanity.
Hi everybody, my name is Jordan Lexton. I'm the founder and CEO of Drive Change. We use the food truck and hospitality sector to run a paid fellowship for young adults who are coming home from jail. I started this organization after being a teacher on Rikers Island and seeing in a culinary arts class that people were using food as a tool to connect, to learn new skills. And so we thought, why not do that with our own business? Now we're partnering with other businesses in New York City to make that fellowship even bigger, even more expansive. I'm gonna let Kirk fill you in on our other programs that are helping us connect food to social justice.
Hey guys. As Jordan's already mentioned, my name is Kirk. Two programs we're really excited about. One's called Awareness Day, where we go to high affluent neighborhoods, and we've designed a menu and we've designed an experience that's really got at helping people understand some of these criminal justice issues that are currently targeting marginalized communities. And Access Day, we go to food insecure neighborhoods, we harvest relationships with local businesses, and we serve nutritious meals to about 500 participants or community members, where we can have these conversations about how to exactly combat those food insecurities.
John, your turn. Go, go.
The dream, right? What's good, I gotta be in front of the mic, right? What's good, everybody? I wanna just shout out New Studio and my brother Jose for making these Apple notes that I had the other day into something real. We're gonna start with a little video.
Hot 97 Morning Show is going down. We are talking about an actual movement of young dudes that are actually creating great a culinary experience.
What is ghetto gastro? The answer to that is multifaceted. Ghetto gastro isn't easily defined. It's a living and breathing entity born in the Bronx. A culinary collective that is breaking every boundary possible, combining food, art, design, and culture into fresh new work. serving the streets with innovative and exclusive dining experiences, immersive events designed to activate all five senses, and engaging storytelling from points all over the globe.
We just like doing interesting things with food, bringing the high and low brow types of cuisine together and with a modern twist.
It's definitely a Bronx thing. We started from a vision, you know, boiling water in a Pyrex. Everyone on the team is strong. Whatever they do, they're strong at it, man.
It's like y'all form together like Voltron.
No question.
So, you know, we put that together because after 6 years, I still haven't figured out how to explain what we do. So let's talk about the Bronx. You know, a lot of people, when they think about the Bronx, they think about, you know, that's the image. You know, it burning. You know, my mom's in the audience, and she grew up in this era of the Bronx. You know, these type of things, hanging over spots. But when I think about the Bronx, I think about a community that displays resiliency and knows how to mine creativity. And this creativity has created plenty of billion-dollar enterprises that the community and the people from these communities, they don't really reap the reward. So we're like on some Empire Strikes Back shit. And that's the vibe, you know? We're about to come up to the most important slide and the only slide that displays diplomacy. And it's do-rag diplomacy. So this is from a trip to Japan where we did a project with Ambush. And one of the examples of us bringing the Bronx to the world and the world to the Bronx is a lot of times people are like, so what are you doing? Like a roast con pollo when you go to Italy? And that's not really the vibe. It's more or less taking the essence and the feeling of what it means being born in the Bronx and applying that with what we learn in different parts of the world. So in Japan, an example of that was we did a Bronx bento box. And some of the stuff we had in the bento box, we did like a Caribbean-style patty, but instead of doing a traditional beef patty, we used Wagyu. And then we incorporated Shiokombo, which is a dried seaweed product from Japan. So just kind of bringing those things together to create this different language, you know? And then, of course, you know, the first thing that happens with us when we get off the plane, you know, it's like, you know, they see the do-rag, they might see a couple of jewels, some fronts, and they're like, what band are you in? You know? Are you rappers? And we like, nah, we cook or whatever. And they're like, oh, if they start bugging out, like, oh, you got to go check this spot and that spot. So using food, I like to think that food, music, and marijuana are some of the best connective tissues in the world, because like you could sit at a table and just really commune over those things. All right, what we got next? That's just vibes, you know. We got on a jet once, you know. And then the next thing is like taking the ideas. So we've exercised bringing the Bronx to the world. And now we're thinking about bringing the world to the Bronx and what that means. So we've been able to forge and establish great relationships and friendships amongst plenty of different verticals. And I was like, all right, how do we take this? Because it'd be a complete waste if we just have all these experiences and they're just ours. So how do we take these things and distill them and create an exercise in physical space making that our neighborhood and our community can interact with? So what we call this is the idea kitchen. So we're looking to procure space in the Bronx and bringing all the great minds together, people like Paola, David IJ, to think about what it means to have these type of spaces in our communities and doing it for us, by us, you know? Because one thing I've always struggled with was asking for permission, and my mom could vouch for that. Oh, I don't get no allowance? All right, I'm gonna hit the black. You know, we gonna make it pop. So that's the vibe. And then we also, our moniker is the Black Power Kitchen. And the feeling that we have with this is really just, you know, wanting to stand on the shoulders of our ancestors and looking at like what the Black Panther Party did with the free breakfast program. And this is another contemporary of ours, our brother AWOL, that designed this. And then a lot of people don't know that the person that coined the moniker of Black Power is Stokely Carmichael Kwame Ture, and he's from the Bronx. So we're like taking these ideas and really distilling them into what we do. I'm not at a 2 minute warning yet?
Yeah, you're done.
Oh yeah? Am I done? Did
yeah,
I go over?
Much. All right,
I'm almost done. And that's just the vibes, you know? And I think that, I think that's it. Yeah.
So what is food activism and what are its goals? Food activism to me is the fight for food justice. And food justice is a huge umbrella term that means many different things to many different people. And I think we can really look at it by thinking deeply about food. And when we think deeply about food, we end up thinking about everything. We end up thinking about the land where food is grown, about all different parts of the environment. We think about the people who grow and deliver our food, who cook it, who prepare it, who serve it, who clean up after it. We think about the conversations we have around our dinner tables. We think about who's invited to them. We think about the stories that are told in food media. So when we achieve food justice, which means achieving justice in our food systems, we'll also achieve racial justice. We will achieve environmental justice. We'll achieve gender equality. You know, it's a huge, huge thing. And I think when we look to our problems, we also find solutions. So if we look at the problems within food systems, we're going to find amazing solutions.
Best Buzz was born out of my desire to change the rhetoric on what it meant to be Somali, refugee, and immigrant. I am from Somalia, born in Mogadishu, raised in Kenya, and sent to school in Seattle. So when I came here and I found out what it was like to be a refugee in an American city, and I was being told all these things about where I come from, I thought an easier way to share my culture and to change the narrative was through food. Food has been a tool for me in terms of building a longer table and a higher fence. Food has been able to allow me to convey my ideas, to share my culture, and as well as offer people a gateway into my culture. So I think that food is a powerful tool in terms of changing the rhetoric for the better. I'm thankful to be able to share that, and I'm grateful to be building a table with so many people around it and experiencing Somali cuisine for the first time.
Fantastic.
No, Lenny. Woohoo! Lenny, yay!
First of all, thank you, Paola and Erica, for having me. And thanks to my co-panelists. This is such an honor to share this conversation with you guys. My name is Lenny Ryan. I am the founder and editor of Mold, an editorial platform about designing the future of food. We publish online, and we also have a biannual print magazine. So when thinking about the idea of gastrodiplomacy, my first thought was, wow, how global is our food system? The food trade has always been seen as a symbol of globalized capitalism. And with our recent trade wars, anyone who has the expectation to have sugar on the table at every meal or avocados year-round should really have an opinion about food and politics. But often, and really also have a perspective on what it means to engage in our globalized food system. But that is often not the case. How many people here in this audience know that we're facing a coming food crisis? Not enough people. In 2014, I was writing about this project by the designer Gemma Warner, and as you can see, it's an infographic using produce to tell a story. And that story is actually a warning from the United Nations that if we continue to eat and drink the way that we do today, that by the year 2050, we will not be able to produce enough food to feed everybody. And based on what Johanna and my other panelists have shared today, this is a completely terrifying fact. Right now, technologists, scientists, biologists, engineers are working around the clock, around the globe, to actually try to figure out how we can produce more food. There's obviously things like vertical farms, lab-grown meat, and also creating new typologies for food. This is a project it's a concept by Live-In Studios, and basically it's a growing system. What you do is you take these agar cups and you inoculate them with mycelium, and then you feed those mycelium cups waste plastic. And as they digest the waste plastic, they knit together to form these little cups that then you harvest and then you eat for both nutrition and hopefully for taste. And what I love about this project is that it actually shows what happens when design gets a seat at the table when you talk about the future of food. Something that seems completely alien to us today, all of a sudden is really personal. It makes sense, it's elegant, and it's something that we live with in our day-to-day lives. Since we're all here to talk about the politics of food, I'd like to posit that design can actually be the ultimate vehicle for gastrodiplomacy, where we can actually imagine and create a new global food system that is regenerative, nutritious, transparent, and accessible for everyone. I believe that designers, with their training to ask the right questions, their human-centered design process, they can actually offer products and solutions that are aspirational and elegant. Designers have a critical role to play in offering solutions for the coming food crisis that we can not only live intimately with, but can highlight the new modes of working that reveal the ways that we're all connected through the food system. This connection is really about ecologies and a whole systems approach to solutions for the food crisis. Instead of thinking of our food system as a linear system from production to consumption, what happens when we reimagine our food system as a complex network that can offer solutions for some of our most thorny environmental problems? Currently, industrial agriculture is responsible for 1/3 of our greenhouse gas emissions, and it takes over 70% of our fresh water consumption. What opportunities are there when we embrace the idea that we're actually all connected in a network of possibilities? I believe that when building a resilient food system, everything should start with the soil. The third issue of our magazine, which is about food waste, we actually interview a number of scientists who are actually designing soil for the farms of the future. And they're doing this through compost, but also through synthetic biology, which is actually designing the living microbes that make our soil work. Soils are our biggest reservoir of carbon on Earth, and they hold a huge potential for carbon sequestering. This can contribute to the fight against global warming and climate change while returning nutrients into the soil. And farmers are on the front line of this, and the movement for regenerative agriculture is actually gaining steam around the world and also in the United States. Does anybody know what this is? It's actually the same mycelium that I showed you guys earlier. This is a mycelial network, and it's kind of what we like to think of as nature's internet. Mycelial networks are intelligent living meshes that connect all plant life on the forest floors. You might know them as our fruiting bodies, which are called mushrooms, which are one of my favorite things. But I believe that the future is fungal. By studying these networks and the regenerative properties of fungi, we might be able to unlock a deeper understanding of ourselves and our relationship with food and the environment. Food waste is one of the most egregious problems of our food system. We currently waste 1/3 of the food that we actually produce. And designers are on the front lines of reimagining food waste as a resource. Not only will we divert food organic waste from our landfills and reduce emissions, but we can actually create and start mining the raw materials of the future by starting with food waste. And then organizations like Green Wave, which is actually based in Connecticut, was started by the fisherman Brent Smith, and they're working to design and scale 3D regenerative ocean farms. Farming our oceans is an inevitability. What sets Green Wave apart is that they're actually trying to learn from the failures of land-based agriculture. They're creating these 3D regenerative farms that can feed people while mitigating climate change. Basically, what happens is they take local species of algae, shellfish, and then create these 3D farms, and then they actually attract local fish into these incredibly complex ecologies. Projects like this, regenerative projects like this, are actually pioneering new modes of thought and operating from a place not of extraction, but of restoration. From farm scale to dining table scale, each person in this room has a role to play in thinking about the future of food, and I believe it really starts with intimacy. Being intimate with something actually means to know something, what it smells like, what it feels like, what it tastes like. And eating is one of the most intimate things that we do, and we often do it unquestionably multiple times a day. In fact, besides sex, eating is the only thing that we do that engages all of our senses. So designing intimacy in our food system actually means designing for the senses. Intimacy can be as easy as knowing where your food comes from, The projects like this is basically called Ambrosis, and it's a blockchain technology. And I believe that designers, their superpower is to actually communicate not only the complexity of our food system, but the complexity of these types of technologies, so that we as consumers can actually connect with where our food comes from. Design can also help us embrace a diversity of food experiences. So what happens when designers create tableware that must be shared? What happens when we can actually connect with one another over the table in new and delightful ways? Studio Tinka is a Dubai-based practice, and they created this amazing collection, and it's inspired by dining practices of nomadic Bedouin tribes. It's tableware without the table. So at the intersection of food and design is actually culture. The world that we live in is composed of objects that are an extension of our values and that are created in the service to culture. And sorry, my last slide is really, okay, I was like, shit, Paola's creeping up. And so in this project is really about how we might be able to design new relationships between ourselves and our food. What will we eat when there's no turkey for Thanksgiving or orange juice for breakfast? By designing dining rituals, we might be able to embrace new ingredients and new modes of eating. This project by Bert and Nita is actually a wearable algae farm. So as you breathe carbon dioxide out, you actually feed the algae, and then eventually you would harvest it for nutrients. In fact, microalgae has more protein per pound than meat. So what designing for the senses can actually help us usher in a new era of ingredients and modes of dining that we may not be able to even imagine right now. Because dining is our earliest cultural performance, I'm interested in designing a global language for dining culture. How can it bring us together at a communal table where we celebrate diverse, regenerative, accessible, transparent food system? Thank you.
So I'm gonna bring you over. So you know where you're staying. John, you sit there. This is where Peter is. And yeah, you sit there. This is Bill. Peter, you're there. And Johanna, you're here. Great. And it's wonderful, the kind of different viewpoint that we had here. I also would like to give a shout out to our friends that are in the overflow rooms. And I wanted to tell you, I was thinking, how do I involve them somehow in the conversation? I'm going to give you my email address. And you can send me questions. Chances are we won't get to the questions yet, but at least you'll know that I'll get them. So it's paola_antonelli@moma.org. I'll be watching my phone and getting your questions. And then we'll all get together. But so it was great to hear all of your viewpoints. And by the way, I think that the teachers of Michi, Konita, and Michael Burton are here in the room, just so you know. Yeah. But it was wonderful because we had all viewpoints, including the sobering viewpoint that Peter brought to the conversation. And I would like to start with the person that I cut off the most abruptly, that is Bill. Because I just thought, just, right, I'm Lisa, sorry.
Kill Bill.
Whoa. I wanted to ask you, Bill, what kind of food would you bring to the peoples of the world to talk about the United States? What were the staples of U.S. food?
Well, that was our sort of charge at the White House was, of course, when you're receiving a head of state or some important dignitary, you want to show respect that you have done some research, you know where they're coming from. But really, the purpose of a state dinner is also to showcase American quality, the regional products that we're proud of, and the techniques and the culinary history that are part of our country. And of course, that means the culinary, the sort of culture of the world, since we all come from someplace else. So our charge there was always to know about the cuisine of the person who was coming to visit, but to interpret the food that we were going to present in an American way.
But this is at the White House, but when you would be traveling. At the White House, I can imagine.
So when you're traveling, I mean, we chose regional recipes to show. I find it sort of off-putting to put too much symbolic power in food. So, I mean, if we take the Thanksgiving turkey or apple pie, when you go to other parts of the world, they're already been so like beaten down by American culture, Hollywood and the economy, and there's so much about America that in the rest of the world is just too domineering. So I found it more interesting to take regional cuisines and present those as an interesting, very small focus on, nice, on different communities.
And I cannot help asking, how could it be that it was mostly white male chefs?
Well, it's certainly a problem to this day. This certainly is something that we in the kitchen, just as we in society in general, need to face. That there's very few women in the kitchen, and it's a tough place to be for women, for minorities, for gay individuals, that it's still a very sort of male, heterosexual, white world. But it's changing. It's changing quickly.
Thank you. Johanna, for you, tabletop diplomacy, right? So it's an idea that goes back to Churchill and before. What are the most successful examples that you can think of this kind of tabletop diplomacy?
Well, in the formal diplomatic setting, I was going to take issue with something Peter said, actually.
Oh, great. Go ahead.
On the China issue. And I don't debate all of the horrible things that you've described. But in fact, there was a survey done after the opening of China that Nixon did. And one of the reasons that apparently the American public liked it so much was because they were familiar with Chinese food. And this was a study that was done by the sociologist Harold Isaac. So I think in terms of success, while I agree that stereotyping a culture by what you think is the popular version is not the way to go, in fact, introducing Americans and their knowing about Chinese food had a very positive effect. And I always posture, you know, what would happen if we had more Russian restaurants? You know, if Brighton Beach had existed earlier, maybe we would have ended the Cold War because people might have liked Russian food. But
such an idealist.
I am. I am. Well, but I do think there are other successful examples. I mean, there's a wonderful book about dining with Churchill. And one of the things that people don't realize is the food diplomacy that went on during the Second World War. I mean, the extent to which each of the leaders went to bring food that people liked. For example, Stalin knew that you could not get oranges in England during the war. And when they had the summit, he sent for oranges in Morocco so that Churchill could have his orange juice. So there are different things that are done by different leaders who knew the peculiarities. The other thing that's very interesting is military food diplomacy, which is yet another example of, I mean, whether you like it or not, a successful way. People don't realize that all through the Second World War, in order to bring these foods to people, the militaries of all the Allied powers paid tremendous effort and role, you know, at great danger at many times, to bring food across to all these summits. So I think those are successful examples. Mm-hmm. And obviously, Bill participated in the Chef's Corps and the work that was done to bring people together, and I think that was one of the most popular efforts that was ever done in culinary diplomacy, thanks both to Secretary Clinton and also to Secretary Kerry. I hope that it will be continued.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. John, the issue of urban development, food, gentrification, there's a lot going on in the Bronx right now and also a lot of protest. So how do you deal with the issue of the kind of development the food brings? How do you balance it with the essence and the personality of a neighborhood?
It's funny because we have this conversation a lot. We've spoken about this. Mm-hmm. For me personally, I think the way Ghetto Gastro combats it is like we charge corporate people, clients, a lot of money so we could have enough money to buy our own property, because the insecurity of and lack of ownership in our communities is kind of difficult to distill and concentrate the power without the financial resources. So we haven't allowed ourselves to be used as a puppet or two for gentrification as like, oh, those are the authentic Bronx dudes. Let's give them 10,000 square feet and let them do their thing so we could hike up these market rate rents. So for us, like we just want to start, use our model as an example of like the for us bias. Like, yeah, we're going to get our resources on our own, do our thing, show. Because for me, I think in the communities, I'm really focused on the youth. And I'm thinking about who I was when I was a child and what examples I had to look at. And I think exposure and having exposure to things and seeing things is like the best tool. So being able to see a young entrepreneur that looks like you or a young woman that looks like you or that listens to what you listen to, dresses like you dress, it's like a powerful tool. So we just want to be that beacon.
And what's the deal with Martha Stewart? I mean, I understand Snoop Dogg, but
this is... We all got some felonies, man.
What?
We were able to connect on that.
Erica, are you right? Oh, okay. I would like to call here Erica right now because I wanted to be able to ask a really good question. So, first of all, Erica, come here. Sit in the chair, in the throne.
Yeah, Erica.
This is Erica's last salon because, you know, she's a 12-month intern, and God bless the education department and the 12-month internship program. She's been fantastic. It's her last salon. The new intern is already here, Samantha. She'll rock it, and Samantha is her. But right now, I would like Erica to have her moment. She's the shyest person on earth, and she's also the cleverest. So go for it. Don't you want to ask a question? Come on, you have some. No, don't cry.
Well, I actually have a question. I think that, like, throughout this conversation, we have had the tendency to talk about food using a certain kind of language, which is a language of personal choice, of personal responsibility. So if we eat bad, if we eat well, it seems to boil down to a matter of personal choice. And my question is, to what extent is it right to do that? Can we talk about the choice that we make in the kitchen as in terms of personal choices?
I'll start. Okay. I'm a dishwasher, so I'm like, I'll just speak for the homies and my partners. Like right now, what we're doing is we really want to focus on working with, like it's not a new idea, but people in the local sphere, and like focusing on plant-based cooking. So partnering with, like, whether it's people in San Francisco making really good plant-based butter, because we want to lead with taste, not like, yo, this is that, you need to eat this. It's like, nah, taste this, it's delicious, right? All right, roll on this side. So thinking about the environmental impact, the health implications that different things have, you know, in the Bronx being, it's home to the largest food distribution center in the world, and it's very food insecure. So thinking about how do we go from the soil to the oil, that's what we like to call it.
I also think that within our current food system, as individuals, we really don't have any power. Like, we can basically, you know, just buy what's available to us. But as a collective, we have a lot of power to actually change the way that food is produced and how we actually access food. And so I think that this idea of personal choice can be a really powerful motivator, like whether it's for health or for just, you know, I don't know, like just general like nutritional value. I think that all these things, the more that we know about our food and the more that we can have some sort of control over where our food comes from, the more powerful we'll be to actually drive like change within the food system.
I'd actually just like to dovetail off of what Lindy said. I think certainly our choices are hemmed in by all sorts of circumstances, your socioeconomic status, where you are, what kind of food availability you have, but, you know, policy also. And I think sometimes, so this has kind of become a pet issue for me lately, and maybe it's a little veering off of gastrodiplomacy, but actually maybe not. So it just blows my mind how hard it is to ferment food in New York City. Mm-hmm. You can't. Like, I mean, you can, but you have to do it under extremely controlled conditions. And it's all because of, you know, city-level regulations. And as a result, we are a fermentation-poor food culture in New York City, which to me is really lamentable because some of the best food in the world is fermented food, kimchi, for example.
A third and of the food we eat is actually fermented.
What's that?
One third of the food that we eat is actually fermented.
Right.
If you think
yeah.
about it, coffee, chocolate, beer, and tea.
And the crazy thing is, I assume that the rationale behind this policy is that it's you know, to make food safer for us. But the whole reason we're fermenting food in the first place is to make food safer for us. So I don't really understand that. But in any event, my bigger point here is this. I can't choose to go to a restaurant and really eat fermented food because policy has made it such that it's actually pretty much impossible to. So certainly we have some choice, but it's hemmed in a lot of ways.
So I was thinking in a different line from your question, Paola, which is what happens when you can't control the access to what you have? And that is the weaponization of food. If you look at what's happening in certain countries, in Syria, the success of the civil war was based on the state's control of flour. And bread is such an essential part of the meal in the Middle East. And when you control the food, and also the seeds, by the way, the government controlled the seeds. If you control these two main sources of what people eat, you control the society. And I think that's the biggest fear with all of these things, that who has access to the food and how it's controlled, whether it's government or whether it's the citizens, is extremely important going forward. And that's why we are able to do and see the horrific things we see.
Based on our kind of current, well, just the U.S. food policy, which is basically our farm bill, do you believe that the U.S. government weaponizes food in the United States?
Do
I? My last question.
I mean, I don't think we weaponize food, but I certainly think we limit choices by the people who have access to it and the floors and ceilings by which people have money to it. But the same happens in refugee camps. Mm-hmm. When the World Food Program and the UNHCR control what people eat. Why do restaurants spring up in refugee camps? Because they don't like the food that's being distributed, and people find alternative means to get them. It's like your search for the turkey. I mean, yeah. In some ways, people there's a way and a means to do it.
And actually, I'll just say add one more thing. So our chef at the museum taught me this. I didn't realize it, but according to him, the reason why chopsticks have to have sleeves but forks don't, so when you go to a place and you have like, you know, a little like cup full of like plastic forks that you can just grab from, but if you're getting chopsticks, they have to all be in individual sleeves. It's all in the regulations. And, you know, you could think of that as being a weaponized form of policy against a particular food culture because chopsticks aren't being used for certain food cultures, but they are being used for others. And so, you know, I think you can find that actually, I think, in a lot of different forms of policy. And I would say even going back to this fermentation thing, I mean, I think for certain cultures, it is absolutely gutting to not be able to, I mean, the fact that Korean restaurants in New York City, not to be tribalistic here, but you know, that we can't make kimchi in like our restaurants, it's just crazy.
And yet the science now is telling us that the microbiome is the single most important part of our body. And so fermented foods, those that feed the biome and that make it more healthy and more diverse is one of the most important ways to build our immunology and to build our general health. But I wanted to say as a chef, your question about personal choice, it's very important. Any chef knows that to change something on a menu or introduce a new food or a new technique is very difficult because people have already these sort of preconceived tastes that they're very fearful of leaving. So one of the great things about what's happened in the last 20 years is that people are opening their minds to new kinds of foods, new ways of eating foods, the way John is explaining and the way the museum has introduced. So it's a very exciting time in food, I think, because people have, we're filling auditoriums on a subject that wasn't
Well,
heard
you're
of.
Filling much more than auditoriums. There's, by the way, I have a question from the overflow room. Thank you for giving me this on a silver tray. So I have several questions from the overflow. I'm going to start with Emily Baltz. Emily asks if the pleasure of eating plays a role in diplomacy. Because, you know, they have to sit at the table. They have to, like, share bread or share whatever else they share. But what about the pleasure in itself? Does it have a role?
Well, I can say,
for it, John.
I was going to say, for me personally, yeah, because if I can't eat with you, I can't do anything with you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, there are lots of stories about Benjamin Franklin in Paris, when he was there and the kind of pleasure he took at these great feasts that he was given when he was representing the United States and before the revolution, also when he was there. And the other thing about pleasure in diplomacy is you want people to enjoy the food if you want to be successful. If you're going to make people sick, you're not going to be very successful. And I think, Bill, you could probably comment on this best, but the people who are most trusted, when you look at people who are trusted, it's obviously not politicians, but chefs come up very high because despite the laws against fermentation, you are willing to go into most restaurants in New York and you're not going to fear that you have to die, that you're going to have, you don't need a taster to come with you. And I think that's something that's very important, that because we put our trust in the people who prepare our food, I think that's an extremely important value that we overlook when it comes to pleasure. I mean,
but I was thinking of pleasure, I was thinking of the opposite thereof, you know, Eleanor Roosevelt and the fact that she was making everything super bland. It's in your reading list if you have time to read that article about Eleanor Roosevelt.
Laura Shapiro's article.
Oh my God, it was so fascinating. So yeah, I recommend that. So we have a lot of super experts in the audience. For instance, Paul Friedman, are you here? Yeah. Oh, Paul, there you are. So Paul is the author of, he's a great professor at Yale, and he knows a lot about the history of culinary diplomacy, and he wrote the book, The 10 Restaurants That Changed America. So I want to give you the word, because you could be, you're one of the people that could be here. Do you have something to ask or something to say?
Well, actually, I wanted to ask the chef, what regional dishes in particular were, because I'm really interested, among other things, in if there's no American, if McDonald's isn't American food, I think the image of American food abroad, the favorable one is variety, but it's a variety of different cuisines, international cuisines, immigrant cuisines. But when you say regional, I'd be interested if you could just give some examples.
I think one of my favorite areas is South Carolina, and so we did a lot of cornmeal type dishes and puddings when in this trip to Uzbekistan. New Orleans, of course, another great culinary tradition, so we would introduce some New Orleans dishes. And then I took with me some ingredients from around the world, like Maine blueberries or filberts from Oregon. And so the idea was to just sort of really personalize and make a very specific example of American cuisine. And but I really learned that the way to win people over was not so much to present these American cuisines as some great find, but was to listen to them. And so in one slide I showed you there, we were making an apple pie, which was fine. They were all like, oh yes, that's how you do it. But let me show you how we make our. And then they just started all cooking together and making these incredible, I mean, who knew there was this such a wide array of Uzbek desserts? So I really felt more effective when I was listening than when I was talking.
I was thinking that the greatest ambassadors of internal diplomacy within the house are grandmothers, but we'll get later, because there's a lot of diplomacy happening also inside the house.
Absolutely.
Any other questions? I'm going to open it to the public. I'm going to go there and then come to you. Okay, the lady with the blonde hair. Yeah.
And then up here. My name is Naz. I'm the founder of Bitten, and many of the panelists have actually spoken at Bitten, so it's exciting to see all of you. I have been thinking a lot about the role of the food critic, especially given that many of the popular food critics that we have are white men, in their review of foods from cultures that are not American foods, and particularly cultures that don't have their food in abundance around the country. And I'm curious if you have any thoughts on that.
Maybe Peter, since you were talking about the...
I have a lot of things I can get fired up over, but this is one. You know, I think you just see in all food criticism just a lot of bias come through, and that's almost inevitable because it's a subjective point of view, right? And you're always going to veer toward the accepted standards of fine dining in the sort of area you're in, and you're going to veer towards foods that are familiar to you, and then other things will be, cast off as being weird or outlandish or out there. I mean, I always am intrigued about thinking about the sort of thought experiment of taking any of the dishes in New York City that we love, including ones that I love, and take it out of the context of New York City and drop it in to my village in Cameroon, right? Take a meal from Blue Hill and drop it in my village in Cameroon, and people would scoff at it, you know? And it's not, they don't have bad taste. It's just, for them, that's just where they're coming from. This is, like, not food, right? And so I happen to love Blue Hill. I'm not hating on Blue Hill. I mean, it's just, you know, I think we have to maybe stop thinking about, and I don't know how you do this without putting asterisks on everything all the time, you know, from my subjective perspective, from my cultural background, all that, that would be exhausting. But I think, you know, we can start by stopping the use of sort of absolute terminology around food, calling certain things garbage or this the best or that's bad. I think there needs to be an understanding that there's a very, there needs to be an acceptance of the relativism inherent in sort of judging what food is good or bad.
One of the exceptions to that prejudice was Jonathan Gold in Los Angeles.
I'm just thinking.
Unfortunately gone last year, but what a great writer. Very sensitive, wrote caringly about all the cuisines in
Absolutely.
LA, and it'll be sorely missed.
How do y'all feel like that, being non-white people?
About
Jonathan Gold?
Yeah.
To be honest.
See, like, it's a different perspective. See, so it's
I know that he's a hero to a lot of people, but I really didn't pay attention to his recommendations first of all, being a New Yorker, like, I'm not really reading LA's like restaurant reviews, and I'm also not really like that interested in watching a documentary about somebody who I'm like, I don't know who you are. That's how I feel.
I would say there's a generational gap. That's where I do think the history has to come in. So I would recommend that you watch him, because one of the things he did in Los Angeles was to really open up a terrain of food criticism to people who were, he was the original gastrodiplomat in that area by going to different places that nobody would touch.
But I would say that's actually opening it up to white people who are maybe not familiar with those communities, where I would say that those restaurants have been existing for a long time because people within those communities had probably been supporting them for a while.
Yeah. I hear.
Can I jump?
John.
I was just going to say one thing about the reviewers. It's like Jay-Z had a verse in Blueprint. I'll just paraphrase. It's like the Pitchfork music reviewer from a suburb in Minnesota that's reviewing Chicago drill music. It's like, if you're not on those blocks to understand the violence and the different gang terminology and the coded language, it's difficult to really review it in a wholesome way. So I'll take it all with a grain of salt, no pun intended.
Is there one reviewer that was white male that you felt really made the effort and that,
He's not a reviewer, but I say Jeff Gordonet from The Times. I think he like seeked out different things and really had a humble vibe about it, but the critics I pay attention to are you, my friends, like my circle. Which spots do I need to go to when I'm in the city? Mm-hmm. I'm not like Googling. I'm not,
No, it's just interesting. I want to make sure that there's a possibility. You know,
I love Robert Sietsema, who used to be at The Village Voice. He's always just
The Village Voice.
I know, rest in peace. I always felt like he was just kind of a very adventurous eater and like really kind of went on his own terms to kind of explore the city in a way that I always really respected.
Yeah, he bigged up a Oaxacan spot in the Bronx.
Mm-hmm. I have one comment. My name is Florence Fabricant, and I write for the New York Times about food and wine. And I have one comment for Peter before I ask my question. I believe there was one exception to the Chinese Exclusionary Act, and that was laundries. Mm-hmm. And that if you were going to open a laundry, you could come into this country. I don't know. Is that correct?
So there were a number of loopholes to get in through the Exclusion Act, and you were opening, actually, is opening a high-class establishment. Then you could come in. And so what would happen then is that investors would come in from China, and they'd open up these sort of palatial restaurants. They're still selling very cheap food, but they would put ornate decor in. I'm not familiar with a specific laundry exception. I do know that Chinese entrepreneurs did often opt for laundry as their business because the capital required to start a laundry business was relatively low. You need a washboard and iron. But yeah, not familiar with that particular one.
And actually, laundry leads to my point. And I don't think we can discuss food, the environment of food, the politics of food, the control of food. Food is complex and local conflict, local, regional, or global, without discussing water. Mm-hmm. And I think if we have a food crisis coming, it's not because of food, it's because of water. Both global warming, which is drying up rivers and lakes and streams, and on the one hand, you have global companies diverting water for their agriculture away from communities, small farmers. You have global agriculture polluting water that makes it impossible to drink in communities that have no other resource for water. You cannot survive without water. And I wish, I know that Lin Yi did touch on water very in passing, but I would like your comments on water as connected to food.
And connected to the politics of food.
Politics. Mm-hmm. Anyone that was in California in 2015 knows how bad it was. The drought was just terrible. And the rules regarding water in California are just whoever's the farthest up on the source, mostly that being the Colorado River, controls the water. And it's controlled by very few people. One of them is the Resnicks of the Wonderful Company, who control most of the water in California. It's a very antiquated system and very unfair.
I think that's part of the problem of the discourse on food. Of course, water is part of the problem. It's an environmental concern. And, you know, the biggest question today is, you know, water is the oil of the 21st century, and we don't talk about it in those terms. But the difference between California's drought and the drought in Syria is that we actually had regulations that people stopped watering, and we had people enforce it. One of the biggest problems in Syria that led to the crisis in 2012 was the rapid relieving of the countryside because there was no water to grow wheat, and only those people who could bribe the people who, you know, who were giving permits to dig wells were the mm-hmm. ones who survived, and the whole water table dropped. So this is a, you know, global problem, and you know, food is a global public good, and water is a global public good.
And it's a system.
Good.
We're all part
and
of the system.
And that's the problem. We haven't defined it yet, so that we isolated it. So if you're in, you can afford the desalinization technologies, you can have water. If you can't afford it, which is most of the world, then that's the biggest challenge.
I have many interesting questions from the overflow rooms. It's hard, but this
come
one,
early next time.
Huh? Yeah, I know. But so this only one, this me? One from Mitchell Davis. Yeah, well said. So from Mitchell Davis, one of Escoffier's greatest accomplishments, he noted in his memoir, is placing 2,000 French chefs around the world in kitchens that solidified French culinary hegemony at that time. Sorry, Italians then afterwards. But what culture owns that sort of power today? McDonald's? Starbucks just opened in Milan this week. Is there a power play here? Peter?
I mean, I would say industrial food in the U.S. is by far the biggest power around the world right now. I mean, everywhere. I mean, just taking the example of chickens, you know, we developed the whole system in the U.S. for creating chickens at, I guess, you know, one way to look at it is incredibly efficiently. And it's a model that is being adopted everywhere in the world, and it just absolutely changes the way people eat. And in a very fundamental way. And so then that gets applied to other animals, it gets applied to agriculture in all forms. So,
Minya, you wanted to speak
on. And I also think that this example of Starbucks is a great one, and it speaks to what Florence is speaking about, which is resource intensiveness of farming and ingredients. I mean, coffee is a very threatened ingredient because of climate change and because the average age of coffee farmers is like 65 years old, and smallholder coffee farmers really get
no money on the dollar that we spend when we buy our like direct trade single origin coffee. And so I think that this question around the global hegemony and like the power of big agriculture and big food in the United States is very real. And I think that, you know, as consumers, we shouldn't, our expectations should really be about biodiversity, and that's what we need to actually be demanding from our food produce, from the people that we buy food from.
Maria, you had one? Yeah, over here.
So we're talking about food as a geopolitical tool and a kind of humanizing force for humanity, and I find myself thinking about space exploration, this kind of ultimate unifying force. And currently, while there are some companies developing national cuisines for spaceflight, there's a Japanese company doing sushi and one in Korea and one in Russia, what's currently aboard the International Space Station is actually primarily American-based food, like cream spinach and shortbread and candy-coated peanuts. And I just wonder, I mean, this distillation of humanity, both figuratively and literally, is not really quite global. And I wonder if you have any thoughts on gastro-astro-diplomacy.
I think that what you touched on is really interesting, because one of the things that I really was struggling with when thinking about this talk is there actually a need for gastrodiplomacy in our very homogenous kind of culinary, like high dining culinary expectations? We've talked about McDonald's so many times. When we talk about the future of food, everyone wants to reinvent the hamburger. And I always wonder, like, why is it always the hamburger? Like, can it be something else? And so this idea around the space station and like it being really American food, whatever that means, it's really about power, right? Like who owns the power and the money to like invest in these things and send things up? Like it's the military. Like a lot of these foods are actually designed and created in the military. And just this year, they finally cracked the code with like pizza. And that was like, I think a 20-year R&D process to actually get pizza to taste good out in the field. And so, I mean, think about how many millions of dollars was put into that process. I mean, is pizza American? Is it Italian? I don't know. But
it's Italian. Don't even ask.
Controversy.
Don't go there. There was a question there.
Thank you. My name is Nasser. I'm the founder of Comida. And although unsolicited, please also check out the Bitten. It's one of the best conferences around that also discusses these type of things. But in terms of what I heard today, we talked about diplomacy, we talked about what's going on in kitchens, we talked about design and food security and empowering community. How do we link all of you together to execute projects or programs that can elevate all these voices and deliver results?
I think having conversations like this, right?
I mean, I'm talking to John about an exhibition we want to work on next year on African Americans and how they laid the foundation for food and drink in America. And I mean, I don't know. I think I see a lot of what we're doing at the Museum of Food and Drink as being very much linked with your work. I think we're all just sort of looking at it from different angles. And I mean, you know, for us at the museum, it's really about trying to help to create this sort of cultural shift toward people being more more curious, more interested in learning about food and drink, and thinking more critically about it, caring about other people more through what we're eating and drinking. And I think all of that hopefully enables the work that everybody else is doing as well. So I think, you know, I don't know if that's really an answer for you, but that's, you know, I think that I see already, without even having known entirely all the work that you guys are doing, I already see that there's a link.
But I think there's also something happening. There was just a recent study out of Harvard Divinity School called How We Gather. And one of the things that they discussed of the means by which we create and institutionalize ways of dialogue, food is one of the most important means, the dinner. And there were these dinner parties that were set up because people don't go to organized religious institutions. They come around the table and they have dinners, particularly people who are young. They may not go to a church, but they'll want to talk about their spiritual need, and they'll do it over food. And Franz Kafka said, you don't fight when you have a mouthful of food. So maybe that's the first step towards peace.
Or when you're kicking a ball.
True.
I, Okay, Barbara, it's the very last one because I have to close.
Who creates the menus at the United Nations?
Who creates the menus at the United Nations? Do you know it, Bill? No, you don't.
Diplomat's dining room?
Well, at the United Nations, I don't know. I mean, the largest gathering that we participated in is called UNGA, the United Nations General Assembly. And
it's coming up. What is
chefs,
it next week?
Yes. Yeah, oh, nightmare. Oh, yeah. You can't move. But the chefs, primarily white and male, that you saw in that picture up there of the heads of state, are often the ones that contribute. Although I would point out that the American chef represented was female.
Christetta.
I'm kind of taking her place today, so I have to kind of give her a shout out.
She's a wonderful
chef and wonderful manager.
Yeah. Yes, she friend. Is.
So, there's so much that we can keep on talking about, but there's the wonderful Emma's Torch food waiting for us outside. And also there's going to be Carrie Brody, one of the founders, is going to be here tonight, and she can tell you about Emma's Torch. And Chef Alex Harris is also here, so you'll eat their food. But just to sum up, as Peter said, this is just an entry point. And it's amazing when there are entry points to culture that are so immediate. You know, the whole time you were talking, I was thinking of design, and I was thinking of how design can also be a soft power tool for middle nations. Mm-hmm. And there's so many different aspects that deal with people's life that are ways to enter a very complex system where food is just the beginning, and then there's water, and there's tyranny, and there's a democracy, and everything is linked together. But it was just amazing to have the five of you here to speak tonight, because your viewpoints are incredibly diverse and at the same time coming together in a cultural synthesis. And I would like to thank also the people in the overflow room, the people in live stream, and then I would like to thank Erica. Come here again.
Yeah.
There's the art outside from the teen program that the Museum of Modern Art puts together every summer. It's fantastic. Just watch it. But let's meet outside and let's ask all the questions that we haven't been able to ask. Thank you. Yay!
Well done.
Yeah,
we should really figure out.
Yeah, I'm like,
yeah. What a wonderful.